I'm really excited for our next talk, which will be by Andres Lasso. Hi. He is a senior research engineer in the Laboratory of Percutaneous Surgery at Queen's University in Canada. His main interests are developing high quality, reusable, open source software components to build systems for translational research and clinical use. He is a core developer of 3D Slicer and a lead developer of several 3D Slicer extensions. Before joining Queen's University, he worked for 9 years for GE Healthcare, working on Inova interventional X-ray systems and Advantage workstation, and led development of advanced image visualization, quantification, real-time image fusion, and guidance applications. He will be talking to us about his experience with 3D Slicer, a long-term sustainability of a large open source project. Welcome.
Thank you for the introduction. So 3D Slicer is an open source medical image computing software that has been developed over 24 years with the main goal of enabling rapid translation of ideas to clinically usable tools. And while the goal of the project is not commercial success, but to move science forward and ultimately improve patient care, the software has been used for building products, and we are in good relationship with companies that use the platform. And I've been a Slicer core developer for 10 years, and I'm excited to hear about what this software does and how we develop it. And it was great to see in the polls that there are many people here who are interested in releasing software and hardware as open source. So I hope that sharing some of our experiences with 3D Slicer could help you as well. And feel free to ask questions, and then I will answer it in the end. So I have no conflict of interest regarding to this talk. And so as I said, Slicer is a software application that you can download, install on Windows, Mac, Linux, and load images, view them, segment, register, visualize them, and so on. And it's all free and all restriction free. So it means that anybody can use it for any purpose. And it's also open source. But in addition to just being a software application, it's also an application framework. So you can customize it to do anything you want. And if any features are missing, then they can be added either in Python or C++. And importantly, Slicer is also a community. On our online forum, we have about 5,500 members now. And we also have regular in-person meetings, at least before the pandemic. But now we are going online and try to continue the traditions. So probably many of you have heard about Slicer, and some of you used it as well. But for those who don't know Slicer or used it many years ago, I would quickly summarize some of the features, mainly those that are important for MRI imaging. So of course you can load volumes, view them in 2D and 3D views, but you can also have other view types like table views or plot views. And not too long ago we added virtual reality display, so anything that you see in 3D with one click, you can see it in an immersive view, you know, any VR headset, and you can interact with the data and move things around and use this immersive view with basically any content. Slicer supports all the data types that come up in any medical image computing applications, so not just images, not just 3D images, but also all kinds of 2D image sequences, depth images, like transforms. This video shows some of the transform visualization and interaction capabilities in Slicer. And you can also display all the data sets, everything fused in one view, so that you can export all the data that you have in one system. Also, a feature that may be important and not not everyone may be aware that slicer has universal sequence support, which means that sequence of any data types, not just images, but transforms or segmentations or models or anything, can manage as a time sequence. And you can also record the time sequences, edit them, replay them, and process them. So in this video, for example, you can see how a sparse rotational cine MRI sequence is reconstructed into a dense volume, or some simple intensity statistics on a 3D volume sequence. And this video shows combination of registering a 4D image sequence to determine a displacement field and visualize that as a transform, and then also apply it to a segmentation so that you segment only a single image slice, and then you apply this displacement field to a segmentation to get a four-dimensional segmentation. Another important feature is segmentation. Like this is one of the most frequently used features of 3D slicer. You cannot just visualize, but also interactively edit segmentations or labels, both in 2D and 3D. And slicer can handle hundreds of segments. It supports overlapping segments, and there are dozens of manual, semi-automatic, automatic segmentation tools, including AI-based segmentation tools contributed by developers of the MRI toolkit and also NVIDIA. Slicer also supports diffusion MRI, so you can display diffusion tensor images, you can compute metrics, visualize them, compute statistics, and you can also do tractography with seeding with points and regions, manage single crossing or multiple fibers, quantify tracts, and also cluster and parcelate clusters or tracts. And for more information, there is a good open access paper about this slicer DMRI extension at this link that explains all these features in detail. We also added FreeSurfer support many years ago so that you can include volumes, labels, surfaces, overlays. And recently we added the capability to also edit these. So you can edit surface parcellations by defining surface curves. And then from defining multiple curves and planes and the set of rules, slicer can put together a complete parcellation. So this can be useful when you need to edit or refine existing parcellations. And of course, you can also edit labels using the segment editor that I showed previously. Maybe not everyone knows that slicer can also be used for interventional guidance. So it can acquire data from a wide range of data sources, from images, navigation systems, various sensors, and record the data, visualize, replay. For example, we can connect to commercial surgical navigation systems. This video shows a Medtronic Star Station screen and a slicer screen, and shows how basically navigation system is mirrored in slicer, and this is a useful approach in general, because then you can add your own custom additions to the slicer navigation screen without interfering with the commercial navigation system. So you can try ideas like this, and this is robust enough that that is used for interventions. For example, here slicer runs on a tablet. The clinician does a quick interactive segmentation, and then they use it for resecting breast tumors. And this is the slicer navigation screen that is displayed to the surgeons so that they know where the tumor is and where they need to cut to minimize the amount of healthy tissue that is excited, but make sure that the tumor is removed. And this is another example with the three slicer used for improving prostate biopsies using MRI and ultrasound fusion. And the last feature of slicer that is important to mention that all data, all the processing, user interface elements, everything are accessible from Python. So you can open the Python console in slicer and start interacting with any of the data or run any custom processing. You can also run slicer as a Jupyter Notebook kernel. So all the features, all the slicer features are available, including visualization and all the Python scripting in a Jupyter Notebook. And if you have any Python packages that you developed or you just want to use, you can all import them into slicer and use them in this environment. So that, for example, you can open load a custom processing package and then use slicer to provide input to that package and visualize the results. So these are the features that are quickly wanted to go through. So this was about how, what slicer does, and now how we get here in those 24 years, and how we're able to maintain and keep adding these features and keep the slicer development alive. And some of these challenges were just how to get started with the project like this, and then how to manage the growth of the project. What about competing alternatives? How we manage funding or developer shortages and the technology changes? So first of all, getting started, I wasn't involved in the project at that time. So it started 24 years ago, and I just joined about 10 years ago. So but I know that it started as a master's project, and there wasn't really any long-term ambition or plan at that time. It just seemed like a good idea, and they just obtained more grant funding to continue and expand the project. And probably the first important strategic decision that was made, that like what license this software should be distributed with. And at that point, there was a debate that it should be a GPL, like a restrictive open source license, or a completely permissive BSD or MIT type license. And fortunately, the decision was to make it completely free and restriction free. So it's not just that you don't need to pay any money to use it, but also you can use it in any way. If you want, then you modify it and put it in a product, or you just take parts of it and use it in any way you want, and without requiring anything in return. And this remained the case, that anybody can take slicer as is or part of it or anything and use it anyway, and like there is nothing is as in return. And what we learned are like very interesting things. That the first of all, that this openness promotes collaboration. Like it's very easy to collaborate when you don't need to talk to lawyers before starting to share code or talking to people, and allows you to talk very openly, because everything, like the main outcome of your work is distributed openly anyway. There is no reason to not help each other. So it turned out to build a very nice and helpful community. And then when you work with such a permissive license, then arrogance is not an option. So you cannot control people or tell people what to do, because like they can just take anything from your software and go with it, and they don't even need to talk to you. So you are kind of forced to be nice and build good relationships, because you cannot force anyone to do anything. And companies, of course, like this licensing, and they are not selfish. So what we see that companies do contribute back to Slicer, because it is worth for everyone when you share development and maintenance and testing between the open source developers and company developers, then it reduces the cost and effort for everyone. And it's interesting that for medical software, there is no direct competition between open source developers and company interests, because even if you develop something that can be used clinically and is very useful, to be able to sell it to anyone, you need to get regulatory approval, and you need to take responsibility of your software. And this is not possible to achieve by a community. It must be. It can all be done by a company. So so there is always added value by a company, and so there is no direct threat, even if somebody develops the same feature as a company. A company will always have the advantage that they actually take responsibility and get the regulatory approval, and so they are they can charge money for it. They can sell it as a product. A small lesson that we learned at that point, it seemed to be a good idea to create a custom license for Slicer, which turned out to be a mix of some Apache licensing with data sharing clauses and including a contributor license agreement. And this is like not a big issue, but overall it's a new sense that we need to always explain how the Slicer license is related to other licenses. So overall it seems to make more sense to use a well-known standard license that you don't need to explain, that people know it very well. And the last comment about licenses, even if it's like completely free and restriction free, and it would seem reasonable for many people to use your software, still often it requires lots of advertising and training and convincing people to use what you develop. So just don't be surprised that people don't just take what you give and run with it, but you still need to convince them that it's good for them. Another challenge that we face, that managing growth. So for example, our user base is growing with a kind of an exponential curve, maybe about doubling in every 3 or 4 years in most metrics. And of course, more users want more features and use the features in new ways. So it's not trivial to how to make make the software sustainable with this growth, and this kind of maps usually nowadays means something bad, that virus spread everywhere. In this case, it means good. It's like the Slicer downloads spread over the world. Basically, it's used in all countries in the world, and we found that what helps to manage this growth is the strong community, a good architecture, and using open standards. So for the community building, someone had a good idea to have in-person meetings regularly. So that's how our meeting started in 2005. And since then, until the pandemic, we met twice a year for a week, working specific projects. Everybody can bring his own project and work on that in small groups. And this was like way superior than many conferences where you mainly present, but it was more like an interactive workshop. And between these events, we had the mailing list and online forums where like lots of discussions are going on. And in addition to this, of course, we give training courses and workshops, and try to use social media to build a community. And also a key factor was to change the application infrastructure to be extensible. So this animation shows how the slicer source code structure changed over time. As you can see, that there are lots of changes till about 2014, and then the structure kind of stabilized. This was due to splitting the code to a core and move most of the features to separate extensions that could be maintained by other developers, not just the slicer core developers. And the result is that we have an app store and extensions index that contains now nearly 200 extensions with all kinds of features that are developed and maintained by various developers around the world. And the third for managing growth is using open standards. And of course, whenever there is an open standard, it makes sense to just adopt it, like using OpenVR or DICOM Web or Jupyter Notebook Protocol to manage notebooks. But for example, there were no protocols for connecting many of the hardware devices that were common in the operating room. And for that, the Slicer community developed the OpenIG Tiling protocol, a new open protocol that allows to connect with all kinds of devices using a single protocol. About the competition, it's interesting because there may be multiple applications or packages that exist for the same task, but it actually doesn't really have to be competitive. Due to the open license, it cannot be like a cutthroat competition, because we can just borrow code from each other. So it's always kind of collaborative. So instead of, we always try to just help everyone and try to find what is common and collaborate on those. And of course, when there are libraries that are commonly used by many software, then it's obvious that if you make any improvements or fixes to any of the existing libraries, then it helps all the applications that depend on it. And actually, it's a bit harder to do that at application level, but it's even feasible for applications, for example, with the developers of the MIT Key application. We created a separate toolkit that is used by both Slicer and MIT Key developers. And that allows sharing application components between similar applications. A little bit information about funding. So it's always difficult to find traditional funding sources for this kind of translational work, because it is too basic, not innovative enough for science agencies, and for companies it's not proven enough, or it's too risky. So what we see that the funding sources that work for us the best are research grants, although from these only a small fraction could be used for software development, but this is an important source. And and there are some specific software infrastructure grants, for example, from the John Zuckerberg initiative, or there are other programs that appear and disappear. So Slicer managed to get some of these grant fundings, and it's useful to keep an eye on this, because they are very efficiently can fund software development specifically. And the secondary funding source is just from companies or universities or hospitals who have funds and then needs tasks to accomplish. So so if you manage to have enough experienced developers who can be tasked with such development work, then you can leverage this kind of funding as well. And of course, there's always either more funding or more developers, but overall in the long term there's mostly a shortage of good developers. So it's always important to keep the good developers around, and the community usually can sustain them. So the last slide about the last challenge, the technology changes, which we find the most challenging of all. So over 24 years, there were many big changes in technology that some of them we managed to the transition was smooth. Some of them are still in progress. So what we try to do is just basically rely on libraries. So choose libraries that in turn like abstract the application away from these technology changes, and so that we don't need to worry about low level technology changes, and also keep our design clean. That allows replacing components, for example, replacing the user interface without worrying about logic or data representation. So like none of these are definitive solutions, but at least reduce the impact of these big technology changes. So in summary, Slicer is an application and platform and community, and it's been successfully sustained for over 20 years. And the key points that I see is the permissive license, have a strong community, and have an architecture that allows extensibility and customization.
Thank you very much for that talk. I really liked how you highlighted the community aspect of it as well. We do have time for one question. Is there any kind of regulatory requirement to use Slicer in a clinical setting? For example, the intervention that you mentioned, does it have to be CE labeled or FDA approved? If not, have you tried to get a FDA approval?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it doesn't have to be, so it can go through a institutional review board or ethics approval, and that process includes assessing the risks. What is the impact of making any mistakes? Is there any chance that because the clinician looks at Slicer, relies on that software, it makes a mistake? What is the impact? How to recover from that? So usually we try to minimize the risk and have an easy way to detect if there is anything is not going as expected, and have a plan of like get out of there as soon as possible and revert to the regular procedure. So this way there is minimum amount of risk, and overall the benefits overweigh those risks, and it goes through the ethics approval. In terms of FDA approval, you need to have a very specific goal or a very specific claim that you make that your system can do. So it's not possible to have a blanket approval for all features of 3D Slicer, but it has happened many times that for specific procedures people approved the regulatory approval, and Slicer is used as a basis or internally in FDA approved medical products.
Okay, great, thank you.